During this component of the fx-300ES Plus overview, we are going to take a closer look at some of the more powerful or lesser known features of the basic keyboard. The first thing we want to do, just to keep things a little quicker and simpler, is I'm going to leave math input output, I'm going to leave math input on, but change this to line output, just to give us decimal values, which I think will be a little more obvious what we're computing. So we'll start off with the log of any base key. This is really handy if you're not computing a logarithm in base 10 or base E, as are often computed. In this case, perhaps we want to compute the log base 4 of 8, and you'll see we get an answer of 1.5. We can, of course, still toggle this to 3 halves if we wish. Additionally, I want to show off the prime factorization. This is usually, this is not a function that you initially compute, it's more of a function you compute after you receive an answer. For instance, if I get 100 and press equals, once I get this answer, now I can press shift and fact to compute the prime factorization. If I have 180, again equals, and then shift fact to compute the prime factorization. We also want to show how to store values in all of these variable locations. The letters, the red letters, indicate variable locations. So if I want to store 85 into variable location A, I press shift store A. Notice I did not have to press the alpha key. It already expects an alpha. So it is already stored in A. That's all I had to do. 25 to store that in B, shift store B. It's now stored. You don't need to press the equal sign. Now if I want to use those values, I can do alpha A times alpha B, and now I can shift store that into C if I wish. And again, it's stored into C. If you ever have a number of values stored and you want to quickly recall, you can press recall A or recall B or recall C, etc., to look at those stored values. We also want to take a look at the permutations and combinations computations, the NPR and the NCR function. So for instance, if I have 10 runners and I want to know how many different ways they might place in first, second, and third place, I can type 10 and then shift NPR to get that P value, and then 3 equals 720 different ways. Meanwhile, if I want to do a similar calculation, but now I want 10 students and I want to know how many ways they can form a 3-person committee, now I'm going to press shift and NCR followed by 3, and you'll see we get a somewhat different computation. I also want to show how to use the greatest common divisor and least common multiple functions. We press alpha and GCD, after which you can enter a few numbers, specifically 2 numbers separated by a comma, and it'll compute the greatest common divisor. Likewise, the least common multiple, again 2 numbers separated by a comma. Now I want to show the integer, specifically the truncating integer or the integer component of a number, as compared with the greatest integer function. We'll press alpha int, and I'll put in a 2.4, and you'll notice it's simply going to truncate this and just grab the integer component, which is 2. To be really clear, I'm going to show you the same function but with a negative input, negative 2.4. Again, it's going to grab the integer component, which is just negative 2. Now, to contrast this, I'm going to show you the greatest integer function. It looks very similar, especially with positive numbers. But what it's really doing now is finding the greatest integer that is less than or equal to the value I put in there, which means it rounds down. Sometimes this is called the floor function. Now, you might think that that has exactly the same behavior as this other function, but let me show you one more example. Now, with a negative value, you'll remember before with the other function, it grabbed the integer off the front. But now you'll notice we get a negative 3, and what's happening is this negative 2.4 is being rounded down, and that negative 3 is really below it. So that's a subtle difference between the integer and the greatest integer function. We also want to show off the random number generator, shift random number. We'll simply generate decimals between 0 and 1. 3-digit decimals. If you would prefer to get a random integer, we can use alpha and then the same key, random int. And now you just need to tell it some boundaries for that random integer. For instance, a random integer between 1 and 6. And every time you press equals, it will continue to generate these random integers. I like to also use random integer from 1 to 6, and then add on another random integer from 1 to 6. And so what this will do is simulate the rolling of a pair of dice and the total of those two dice. You can get very creative. You can make fractions out of these and so on and so forth. Now, many people are tempted to think this key right here is a random key, but what it actually is a rounding key. And to make this a little more clear, I'm going to change our setup to fixed decimal notation. I'm going to set it to a fixed 3-decimal notation. So now when I do 10 divided by 3, we get 3.333. The reason I want to show you this is if I now multiply that by 3, we get 10 again. And what is key about this is that the 3.333, which was visible, still in the background was represented as a repeating decimal, so that when we multiplied by 3, it knew we were coming back to 10. However, if I do the same computation, but now I tell it to round this 10 divided by 3, it now is going to cut it off right here as far as what is displayed, and so now it is only 3.333. It forgets any remaining component to that decimal, and so now when I multiply by 3, we get a 9.999. You lose a little bit of information when it's rounded. You may ask why you would want to do that, and it really comes in handy in a scientific circumstance where you specifically want to keep your measurements at a certain number of significant digits, and we don't want to pay attention to any more than that. A few more things we can convert from polar and rectangular coordinates. For instance, if I want to convert to polar coordinates, the value at the rectangular coordinates of root 2, comma, root 2, press equals, and now we know that in polar coordinates that would be a radius of 2 and an angle of 45. Likewise, we can convert into rectangular coordinates from a root 2 and 45 degrees. And it will put it into rectangular coordinates at 1, 1. Lastly, I want to show this DRG button or function. This allows you to specify the units of an angle measure. Often it is assumed that it is the mode that we are set in. Right now we're in degree mode, so all angles like this 45 are assumed to be in degree mode. However, if by chance I wanted to compute, let's say, the sine, and let's just do this quickly in degrees, the sine of 90 is 1. Now if I wanted to put this in radians instead for some reason, but I didn't want to change the mode of my calculator, I could put this in as the sine of pi, let me put another parenthesis there, the sine of pi over 2, and now I'm going to use this DRG key to specify that I want radians. I'll press 2 for radians and close the parentheses. And you'll see that even though I entered that in radians, it is still going to correctly compute the sine even though I'm in degree mode, because we told it we were using radians. This concludes our second look at the features of the fx-300ES+. In our following videos, we'll be taking a closer look at the table and statistics modes.